As you registered, or perhaps you already had, a copy of this book, The Prophetic Voice in Making Peace. This is a volume that was created out of a colloquy that we held last summer in Syracuse. And it takes up five different topic areas related to issues in campus ministry. The first section is on environmental ethics. That's followed by the section on interfaith dialogue, sexual ethics, racism, and Christian vocational discernment. So there's chapters in there on each of those topic areas. And the intention is, if you are a campus minister or there's a campus minister that you love, hand them a copy of this book or have a copy. And if you are leading a discussion on environment, on the environment, you could read one of those chapters as something to give you clues about what you might want to talk about, or even use one of those chapters as a discussion area. We have just finished the second colloquy in this series that we did in Cambridge over the summer, the hottest summer week in Cambridge, England in recent history. I think, didn't it get up to about 95 degrees one day? So if you've ever been to any of these university towns in England, they don't use air conditioning and at all. And when it's 95 degrees, it's hot inside. And my sleeping room was at the peak of a top floor of a five-story building. And so these buildings are designed to escape the heat through the peak, right? So where did all the heat go? Right to my bed. It was so hot. But bless my heart, y'all don't really care about that it was hot when I went to bed.
And Sarah had a party.
Huh?
And Sarah had a party outside your window.
Oh, yes, Sarah. We don't know who Sarah is, but Sarah had a party one night that went till 1 or 2 in the morning. Anyway, y'all don't really want to hear about that. You want to hear about resources. So that volume is on immigration students as immigrants and refugees and people who feel as though they're displaced from an environment that they're comfortable with. So it's called Displaced Persons, and that will be coming out next year. We're currently working on our colloquy topic for next summer. That will focus on racism, and we are going to be having the call for papers for that. So if you are interested in writing on that topic and engaging in that in some kind of way, pay attention to our website, which is not explorecalling.org, but umcollegiate.org, and you'll see information about that colloquy coming up. So this is the first volume in it, and we've provided a copy of it for you. If you don't carry books around with you, you can buy the Kindle version, which is available on Amazon for, I think, about $19. Also, you received coming in a copy of The Term, which is our worship and preaching journal that Tim Moore is the general editor of. This just came out. I mean, it's just about 3 weeks old. We've had some excellent and positive feedback from people out in the field who are using it to support their campus ministry. This is written by campus ministers for campus ministers. It will help you plan worship. It'll help you prepare your sermons. It'll give you some visual and poetic guidance in various kinds of ways. It's a beautiful little book. It comes out twice a year. We'll be offering it by subscription. So I think the subscription, Tim, is a $20 a year subscription.
$10 a year subscription, or $20 a year just to buy them each time.
Ah, so you can subscribe for $10, or you can buy them both for $20. But if you subscribe, we'll give you both for $10. Mm-hmm. Doesn't that sound like a deal? That's a good church deal right there. Make sure you take this copy, because if you have a reflection or a sermon or a prayer or some artwork that you have done and you feel like others would benefit from, we are taking submissions for upcoming volumes.
We've already received some.
For the spring one that is coming, yes. So please pay attention to that. Oh, and I have to show you this because it just delighted my soul. This is from Amazon.com, where you can buy the book. You see up there, number one new release in Methodist Christianity. Now, you have to wonder what the base metric is for it to being the number one in Methodist Christianity, but nevertheless, there it is. It was there. I don't think we're number one anymore.
No, but we took a screenshot of it.
We did. All right, so I want to talk to you a little bit about the rule to grants. These are some grants that we've made available out of the World Service apportionment that our office receives. And our first round of grants went out this year of about $50,000 to 16 programs across the United Methodist Connection. And these grants were designed and intended to support creative ministry ideas, innovation in ministry in some kind of way. And so all the grants are a little bit different. And what will happen with these is we'll get some feedback from the grant recipients and hopefully be able to develop some resources for you in your conference or you in your campus ministry setting to implement if you're thinking about doing a similar idea. So this is a form of grant making toward resource creation. So we're hoping out of this to be able to create resources that you can use, that you can pick up on to give you ideas in your own setting. We do have the second round of grant applications coming up. And so I want to show you a video that will give you a sense of what we're going to be asking people to do in a sense. This is not about campus ministry, it's about washing machines. So just I want you to pay attention really to the idea that's presented here. Okay, this is going to be what we're going to be looking for. All right? And because my computer decided to do things differently all of a sudden, I have to do this. All right, this is about washing machines.
When I wake up in the morning and I find out I have no clean clothes, I usually end up just staying home. When I was homeless, we had no clean clothes because we only had a little bit of money and we used that money for food.
I think people don't talk about not having clean clothes because, I don't know, it makes you want to like cry or go home or run away or something. It doesn't feel good.
If they miss school, then they're not going to get their education. And if you don't have an education, you can't do anything. And they really deal with a lot of, like, just very practical challenges that I never had to face.
We have a washer and dryer at home. It's just that our electricity was shut off.
If there are kids whose education is at risk because they don't have access to clean clothes, that's something we can help with. Care Counts is really about seeing how laundry can impact attendance rates. And how we're able to do that is providing washers and dryers into school districts.
It was so exciting because I could think of like 20 kids off the top of my head who, boy, this is going to make a difference.
They want you to put as much clothes as you can fit in a bag, and then they have you bring them to the school, then they wash them.
Since the program has been in the school, my attendance is consistent. The goal is 90. We have over 90% all the time.
I can just look at specific kids and know that because they're in the program, they've been at school every day this year.
Before the program, I think I would have said, you're crazy. A washer and dryer? That seems way too simple. But I think now looking at it, I think we know that it's made a positive impact.
I definitely think the program has long-lasting impact because if it gets kids to come to school, then they can work to get an education and, you know, get out of poverty and help their families get out of poverty.
We originally started this hoping to impact attendance rates. What we didn't realize was the impact that it would have on so much more.
How I feel with clean clothes, hanging out with my friends, I feel like nothing can stop me.
All right. What'd you think of that? That's cool. So this was someone had an idea. It was actually a school teacher, I think, in Pennsylvania, I remember reading, who had an idea that perhaps the reason some of her students are attending class on a regular basis is because their clothes aren't clean. It was just an idea. And as you heard one of the teachers say, when they first heard about it, they thought it was ridiculous that it would make a difference on attendance and participation rates. But you saw the data up there of the students that they tracked, that the tracked students' attendance rate increased up to 90%. So 90% of them were present 90% of the time for the school days, for a total increase of 2 weeks over a school year, which is a significant amount of time of educational instruction time. This is the kind of innovative, creative thing we want to fund out of our grant process. We have one that was reported on Michigan Public Radio at Ferris State University. Jeff, is this in your area?
Yes, it is.
All right, so I want to play something for you guys, and again, I have to, this one will work. This is the program at Ferris State.
You're listening to Stateside. I'm Cynthia Canty. There is no doubt college expenses are rising. Trying to pay for tuition, books, a place to live, food, all of that can stretch a budget beyond its breaking point. A senior criminal justice student at Ferris State knows that struggle, and she's seen it on her campus. And that's why Olivia Johnson began the Student Emergency Food Pantry for Ferris Students. Olivia, how did you come up with this idea of a food pantry for students?
I'm actually active in a lot of mission work throughout the year. I've been to places like New York, North Carolina. I've even been to Haiti, where I've seen more than one need from the community, but also even here at Ferris State, I've seen the struggle and the need of students when it comes to food and not being able to afford room and board. I actually jumped on this task when I heard the story of a young man who could only afford to eat a slice of pizza a day, which would be a box of Little Caesars a week. And through that, I decided to do something about it, and I wanted to do my part for our community and just let people know that I understand where their pain is coming from, and I understand their need, and I just wanted to act on it.
And so how much food could a student get, and how does someone qualify?
As far as qualifications, there aren't any, as long as you're a Ferris student. So when you arrive to the pantry, you must have your student ID, and there is a simple form to fill out just so that we can understand who we're talking to here, whether or not, you know, you're a student, what level of your education you're in, whether you're on campus or off campus. And after you fill out that form, you are able to get food. We supply you with up to a week and a half worth of food. So we give you a lot of, like, rice and noodles and pasta, soups. We give you cereal, pancake mix, and things of that sort, things that last a pretty long time.
And where did you get the food items, donations or funding?
So we actually, my campus director and I actually partnered up and we wrote grant proposals to the Board of Higher Education, and we received a $2,500 grant, and we went out and we purchased the food. But beforehand, I attempted to establish partnerships with places like Walmart and Meijer, and I wasn't able to connect with them, so we just continued to just push forward, and we went out and we purchased the food through the grant, and we always seek volunteers, we always seek out people who want to donate as well.
Now, this does seem like a temporary solution to a really much bigger problem. Olivia, what do you hope that this food pantry says to school officials, not just at Ferris, but other campuses?
Well, it's a need, and I think that that's something that's really important, that it shows the universities in our state alone that this is something that students need, that it is also, you know, important to bridge the gap between higher education and hunger. Just because you're into college does not mean, you know, you don't have other needs that need to be met. So even as far as students working two or three jobs and still being full-time, there's something still missing there. And so even though we only provide a temporary solution, we just want to fill that that missing link for students.
Ferris State senior Olivia Johnson, who's the founder of the Student Emergency Food Pantry for Ferris students. Olivia, thank you for sharing your work with us.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate the opportunity.
You're listening to State Side. I'm Cynthia Candy. You don't want to hear it again?
College.
Isn't that amazing?
Yeah, that's great.
All right, so this was a student initiative. A student recognized that I have multiple mics. There we go. So a student recognized that there was a need in the higher education context to feed students because she was a student and she saw it happening. And so she did something about it. And we were able to help fund that to make sure students have food. Isn't that, I mean, you don't naturally make a connection between hunger and higher education, which this student did. Sheila just told me as I started the audio that Olivia is going to be one of the speakers at Next 2016. I imagine that she's going to talk about this experience too. So these are the kinds of grants these are the kinds of programs and ideas we want to fund. Things that are paying attention to the immediate context in which a campus ministry is located. So when we ask people to send us grant applications, we're going to be asking everyone to do a complex contextual analysis of the location you seek to serve to make sure that you understand the setting of that ministry. So what are the demographics of the school? Are they commuter? Are they residential? What's the mix there? There's a whole host of questions that we're going to be asking so that you can understand the context that you're serving in. So pay attention. Rule 2 grants, again, umcollegiate.org is the place to go. You can also follow us on Facebook, and we put a lot of stuff there too. So the grant applications for that will be opening up soon.
What's Rule 1?
Rule 1, okay. So this is a group of Methodist in the room, you should know the 3 general rules of the United Societies, which are rule number 1, do no harm, rule number 2, do all the good you can, rule 2, and rule 3, okay, I wondered how many of you had read Reuben Job's book, you know, yeah, so Wesley, attend to all the ordinances of God, or stay in love with God was Reuben Job's language. All right, so that's rule 2. Any other questions about these resources that you have, the 2 books and the grants, before I move on to the next thing, which I'm going to start flying really fast, all right? I'm going to turn the water hose on. Okay. Here's our schedule, and we're already almost all the way to the 3 o'clock break. After you get checked in, Sheila will start at 3:15 with telling the story of collegiate ministry. She also has some help today, and that is
Michelle Maldonado
from UM Communications. We'll be joining her with that. You also have in your folder an agenda, and I just want to highlight a couple of things for you real quick. We have dinner tonight. It's at 6 o'clock here at Scarrett Bennett. Okay, let me get it again. Dinner tonight here at Scarrett Bennett, 6 o'clock. If you've not been to Nashville before, or even if you have been here before, we have so many opportunities for Nashville culture and, you know, 7 days a week. So if you like music, find a place that's playing music. Find a copy of the Nashville Scene. It has a list of all the music and cultural events going on around you. Monday nights at Station Inn, sometimes there's a pretty cool band, and occasionally folks like Vince Gill and whatnot will pop in and do a set. So pay attention to the music if you like that. You can go and do that after dinner tonight. Tomorrow, Breakfast is available starting at 7:30, and then we'll have our morning devotion here about 9 o'clock and get started with our training sessions. John Weaver is coming in the morning to talk about creating training and managing local boards of directors and also some basic fundraising strategies for local units. John's a good person to talk about this topic because he has done this in one of the larger Wesley Foundations at Auburn and is working now at MTSU Wesley Foundation in Murfreesboro, Middle Tennessee State, and is having to do a lot of this work of board development and setting up these basic fundraising strategies for that institution. So we're looking forward to welcoming John. We also have Demetrio Beach, who's right over there, and he will be talking about managing and developing new programs and initiatives. And then Tim, in the afternoon tomorrow, will present a new resource for evaluation and assessment. And it's a very thorough product that we have available for you, and we'll send you away with another book. But this one's more of a binder. I might have to let this wireless go. Yeah. Hold on a second. Sing to yourselves. You're not singing. Okay. And that gets us up to tomorrow night at 4:30, the 150th anniversary of the Board of Higher Education celebration is happening tomorrow night at 4:30, just across the street. You won't be able to miss it because I understand there'll be a huge tent and there will be food and displays and speeches and all kinds of wonderful things. And Sheila Bates is one of the MCs for that event. And she's so excited. Aren't you?
Yes.
All right, so that's at 4:30. And you see on there, after that, it says dinner at Skerritt. We don't have dinner tomorrow night here because dinner's across the street at the 150 celebration. All right, and that's going to be, I understand it's going to be, they call it barbecue, but I imagine it doesn't look like the barbecue Jeffrey and I and the others from Texas know about. It's probably pulled pork. Yeah, see, barbecue is sliced beef brisket on some white bread with a pickle and onion sauce. Tomorrow afternoon and Wednesday morning, you're going to have an opportunity. We'll have three breakout sessions. They will be identical sessions on tomorrow afternoon and Wednesday morning. One will be in here. One will be in this space right next door. And the other will be up in the Clyde and Mary Hole room on the second floor. And you can see the three topics. So you have an opportunity to engage in two of those three. To discuss whatever is of interest to you. So those will be smaller breakout sessions. And then we'll conclude on Wednesday with a closing plenary to answer any questions and make any other connections you want to make. Any questions about the schedule? Okay, are you ready for paragraph 634?
Sure.
All right, paragraph 634 in the Book of Discipline is the paragraph that describes the basic contours of the Conference Board of Higher Education and Campus Ministry. And this is how it begins. There shall be in each annual conference a Board of Higher Education and Campus Ministry or other structure to provide for these functions and maintain the connectional relationships. All right. So as in terms of a sentence that makes sense by itself, this is not one of those. Because you have to wonder, what are these functions and what in the world is meant by the connectional relationships? Well, those are described in the paragraph below. But what I wanted to point to is that nifty little word there, shall. Shall is not an optional word in this usage. Shall does not mean you may. It means, in essence, you will have some kind of structure that supports campus ministry and higher education in your annual conference. There's, according to discipline, the way shall is used throughout, there's no option. You have to have some kind of structure. that supports and advocates for higher education and campus ministry. I know that not every annual conference has this structure, and I know that it's absent in certain places for different reasons. And those reasons could be because they couldn't find enough people interested in it, or that they nominated people, and this is the one I just most recently heard of. The conference board of nominations nominated people for the conference Beckham, but didn't tell them that they were nominating them for them. And so it came to the floor of the annual conference, and they said, no, I don't want to serve on that. No one asked me about that. And so now they don't have a conference board. So maybe the conference nominations committee learned their lesson, but I don't know. So one of my primary jobs in my role at in the Collegiate Ministry Office is to interact with conference leaders to help establish, build, and support strong conference boards of higher education or similar structure. All right. So similar structure means some kind of an officially recognized way of doing evaluations, assessments, support, and accountability and advocacy for campus ministry. All right. So this is how paragraph 634 begins, and it is a barn burner. I mean, you can hardly wait to put the book down, all right? But there are five, what I'm going to go through are the five general areas of responsibility for the conference Beckham. And you can go and read these in more detail in paragraph 634 on your own, and I was commenting to Sheila this morning that there's no logical order to how this paragraph was put together. In fact, I discovered two subsets that are almost exactly alike in the same paragraph subsection. So there's subsections of subsections that sound exactly alike. It's like they forgot to talk to one another. But that's our book of discipline that's made by a huge committee over time. All right, so the first area of general responsibility is just the general overview. The conference Beckham is there to interpret and promote higher education ministry, and especially those within the annual conference. In essence, the conference Beckham is there to tell the story of campus ministry. All right, to interpret and promote, to tell the story, to tell people about it, to be present when there's an opportunity to share the story of campus ministry, to go to the Council on Ministries or whatever it looks like in your annual conference. In fact, the board chair of the conference Beckham, you know what I mean when I say Beckham? I've heard others say Beheckham or Beheckham. The chair of that board is a member of the Council on Ministries for the annual conference. This is an annual conference board, all right? So it reports to the annual conference. And I've said this to a number of Beckhams. You need to have the ability to speak on the floor of annual conference, all right? Because this is an annual conference board. It is not something that another committee can decide to put off of the agenda. Because it's an annual conference board, it really does need to speak directly to the membership of the annual conference whenever it meets. And you, as an annual conference board member, those of you who are here in that capacity, need to insist on that, because it's not going to be given to you. You need to point out that this is an annual conference board and therefore reports to the membership. It doesn't necessarily only report to some other entity within the annual conference structure. Okay? So in the realm of general responsibilities, to recommend policies and guidance to the programs, to train and provide resources for local churches that have campus ministry programs as part of their ministry, to work with the Conference Council on Ministries or the structure that you have to promote and interpret campus ministry in your setting, to talk about the loan fund. This tells you a little bit about how old this paragraph is. It only says to talk about the loan fund. All right, we also have scholarships too. We also give money away. All right. So when it says the loan fund, it's also talking about scholarships. And that's one of the reasons we had Allison here, so that you know in your role that we have as a United Methodist Church, loans and scholarships that are available to your students. So part of the Beckham's responsibility is to help students know that these resources are available to them. To evaluate schools, colleges, and universities and programs related to the annual conference. This is a little bit of a hairy one because the colleges and universities that might be within the bounds of your annual conference might not be really interested in an annual conference board wanting to come in and evaluate and assess them. In fact, I could tell you that their interest level in you doing that is negative. You would not be welcomed in that capacity if you were saying, we're the annual conference board, you're a United Methodist school within the bounds of the annual conference, we're gonna come in and evaluate you. The president of that institution would say, no, thank you. No, thank you. They don't need that. They're evaluated and assessed through their accreditation process. And they have a relationship to the United Methodist Church also through our Office of Schools, Colleges, and Universities at GBHM. But what the conference board can do that college presidents will absolutely love is promote their school. To tell people in the annual conference that we have in our annual conference a United Methodist school. And isn't that great? Look how wonderful the school is. Look how it supports our students and ministries in our context. Those are the kinds of things where the conference board can really help in the context of a conference-related school. So those are the basic general areas of responsibility, which basically comes down to telling the story and advocating for campus ministry, all right? So that should be great news, because if all you really have to do is tell people fun stuff all the time about how awesome college students are, that's great. Am I right?
Right.
All right. I know it's nearly 3 o'clock in the afternoon and we don't yet have our coffee service. And you've had lunch, and I know this is the siesta hour. And that we're talking about the Book of Discipline. So you put all of that together, and it's just a snooze fest waiting to happen. So I apologize for that. But I also do not like the British model of conference meeting when you break for tea, and then you meet for a couple more hours, and you break for dinner, and then you meet for a couple more hours, and sometime around 10 o'clock they let you leave, so you can come back at 7 o'clock in the morning and keep going. I'd rather get through this stuff, and if you have questions, to ask me the questions, and we can talk one-on-one, and then you have the evenings free to relax, because most of you are probably like me, you don't get really to have much time to yourself unless you're not at home. So this is also a Sabbath for you, I hope. Maybe not this next few minutes, but later on. The second area of responsibility for the annual conference Beckham is fiscal. Fiscal is a word that kind of encompasses financial and legal aspects of these campus ministry programs. One of the primary things that the annual conference Beckham is going to do on behalf of campus ministries like Wesley Foundations and ecumenical programs supported by the annual conference is to present and support and advocate for the financial needs of those programs. Guess what? If the annual conference board doesn't do it, guess what happens? It gets cut. Has anyone had that experience in your annual conference where no one was speaking on behalf and support of campus ministry for an extended period of time, and then the CFNA, those people said, well, y'all don't do anything important. You're just out there having fun, spending hundreds of thousands of dollars of church money. So we're just going to cut it. And you can keep doing whatever you want, but you're going to do it with less money. Does that sound like an effective strategy of advocacy and promotion for campus ministry? No. The answer is no. All right, let me tell you. This is autobiographical again. This is one of the reasons why I got into this line of work. I was the Tennessee Conference Beckham chair. All right? I mean, it was they gave me not an office, they gave me no car, nothing. They did say CFNA, said, Brad Fiskus, this is what they told me, do not ask for any more money. Because you're not going to get it. And in fact, we're going to cut your budget. And I said, okay. So I went and asked for more money. I did. I went and asked for more money, and guess what? I didn't get cut the first year. All right, that was Tom Gildermeister and I working in tandem. We didn't get cut the first year. We took that as more money. So they told us when we left that meeting, don't you come back here next year asking for more money. So guess what we did? We went back after we did a thorough evaluation and assessment and report on our campus ministry programs. We went back and guess what? We asked for more money and we got it. And then we reported again on the successes of our campus ministries next year. We went back to CFNA and we asked for more money and we got it. And we did it again and we got it. And then we added a program, so we added more money. And then our program at Austin Peay, where Katie is just exploding. And so we added more money. So when I started on the conference board, the annual budget was about $420,000 in Tennessee, which I've learned sounds like an awful lot of money to most annual conferences for campus ministry. $420,000, and they told me, don't ask for more money. What's it now, Brad?
It's about $750,000.
$750,000. Because we were able to convince conference leadership that campus ministry was a ministry priority of the annual conference and it should be funded fully. If this is the only thing you go away with is permission to go to CFNA and your conference leaders and advocate for campus ministry so they can be fully funded to do good work in the world with students, then I'll be happy. All right, don't be shy about advocating for the programs that you believe are important. There is another annual conference, and I will not tell you which one, and I don't think any of them are in this room, but they have an extraordinary camping program. And guess what? The director of the camping program sits on the CFNA board. Guess who gets fully funded every year? Just guess. Camping. Guess who got cut last year? Campus ministry. And when I asked, did you have someone from your conference, Beckham, there at CFNA advocating for campus ministry? Said, no, we didn't know. We were told we couldn't do that. That we had to go through this other system. And I said, no, you're an annual conference-related entity. You have direct connection to CFNA. Not a tangential one, but a direct one. There might be people in conference staff that you need to interact with in order to keep the conference structure intact in the way that it's prescribed. But the conference board of higher education campus ministry has a direct connection to CFNA and a direct connection to the annual conference membership. Okay? You don't have to ask permission on that because the Book of Discipline has already given it to you. There will be pushback in some annual conferences if you insist on it. But be nice. I mean, it never hurts to be nice. But you can be nice and strong at the same time. So in terms of the fiscal responsibilities, that's one of the primary ones, is to advocate for directly to the money folks about the financial needs of these programs. Monitor other various financial and legal issues. If you can imagine a financial or legal issue that impacts your church, then they also impact a campus ministry. So there's things about personnel, budget, buildings, trust clauses, reversionary clauses, legal issues that come up from time to time and so forth. Imagine it happens in a campus ministry too. The annual conference, Beckham, is to be a resource person for those occasions. And to keep tabs, to understand what's the financial picture of a campus ministry in your setting. Is everything okay there? Does there need to be an intervention if the financial scenario is not good so you don't end up losing a campus ministry building to the IRS, for instance, which has happened, or losing it to receivership to some other organization that decided that it would be good to build a residence hall without having the funding to back it up. And so someone else bought the note, and then they foreclosed on you, and now you have no campus ministry building whatsoever. All right, if the conference Beckham had perhaps been a better monitor of the fiscal issues there, maybe those scenarios wouldn't have played out that way. Establish foundations and endowments. Guess what? You have disciplinary permission to save money for campus ministry. Go to your conference foundation and say, we're going to set up an endowment program for campus ministry, and we don't know what money we're going to have yet for it, but we want to open the account. And more than likely, if you have an annual conference-related endowment program, they will open that account for you, and money can start flowing in. In the Tennessee conference, we got the Episcopalians to pay for it. So that's always a fun way if you can get someone else to pay for your Methodist campus ministry. It's always nice. Counsel around issues of property, trust clauses, reversionary clauses, all those kinds of things. So you have to know a little bit. We actually engaged a conference chancellor from time to time to answer any of these legal questions. Your annual conference has an attorney, a chancellor, who is contracted to answer these kinds of questions for you. So make sure you take advantage of that. If you have those needs, use the resources that the annual conference already has available to you. And of course, also administer the loan and scholarship funds. And you heard what Allison said. If you have a significant loan and scholarship fund program in your annual conference, and it's a burden to manage, our loans and scholarship office can do all the management for you through their program. So definitely reach out to Allison if that's something that you'd think would be helpful. The third area is schools, colleges, and universities, which I already mentioned. Talk about them. This is what really helps the schools in your conference, is that you as annual conference leaders are supporting and talking about those programs. And if you go up to them and say, hey, college president, I want to help you raise money and recruit students. I don't know that there's many that would say, no, I don't want that kind of help. I think perhaps all of them would say, yes, please help us raise money and recruit students. Because many of our schools are smaller liberal arts schools, many of them are tuition driven, so they have to hit their enrollment targets in order for their budget to balance. And so it can be a year-to-year struggle for our United Methodist schools to hit those enrollment targets so that they don't have to balance their budgets by cutting staff or programs. So any way that the Conference Beckham can assist the schools in that would, I'm sure, be welcome. Of course, you know, I would go talk with the college president or provost or something of that nature before you decided to make any kind of effort on their behalf, because they'd like to know, don't you think? Right. Oh, and this other area is to represent the annual conference to the schools, colleges, and universities. So when you do have an opportunity to meet with the colleges and universities in your context, remember who you're there representing. All right, be a good representative of United Methodism in your area. Be kind, considerate, and open, and willing to be helpful. Rule number one, do no harm. Rule number two, all right, so keep those, at least those two, in mind as you walk around. All right, number four, and this is a big area. The biggest section of paragraph 634 is the part that deals with campus ministry. I want you to go read it. All right, because this is one of the areas where the Conference Board of Higher Education and Campus Ministry can really help the local Wesley foundations and ecumenical programs by offering training and support for their local board of directors. So one of the reasons why we're bringing in someone to help you understand how to build a local board and do some basic fundraising strategies is so that you can then go and tell your local units some basic ideas about how they might raise money and organize their board. So this is one of the ways that the conference board can really be helpful. Talk to the ministries about, or talk about the ministries to the local churches. One of the things that we hear all the time from campus ministers is they feel like the churches don't think they exist, or they've forgotten about them, or they're out there on their own. Advocate for the ministries to the churches. Remind the pastors of local churches that indeed down the street is a United Methodist campus ministry staffed by United Methodist seeking to create disciples. I go to district ministers meetings just about every time they happen. And if the DS will let me, I'll stand up and talk about campus ministry in the Nashville area, or campus ministry generally, just to remind pastors that this work is happening and it is important. Support students. Do that. Don't not support students. Support students. That's what campus ministry really is, the heart of it, is supporting students in their spiritual walk. And here's the fun stuff. Establish procedures for selection and termination of staff. Develop policies for determining new ministries and new buildings or discontinuing ministries, and working with ecumenical programs. The part about hiring and firing staff people comes up just about every year, because depending on who the bishop is, depends on what the answer to that question is. I've had the same bishop change that bishop's mind about the conference board helping hire somebody, and then all of a sudden this bishop wanted to make an appointment rather than hire somebody through a national search, which is what the paragraph 634 calls for. And it can work out. Just my advice to you is to make sure you're talking with your bishop whenever a scenario like this arises, when there's a hiring or a termination that is necessary. Make sure you're in the loop, and that the bishop's not kept out in the dark. There's nothing worse than an angry bishop who hasn't been told what's going on. You want to get an appointment to somewhere you've never heard of or seen before? Make a bishop mad. And then finally, yes, sir.
Let me ask you a quick question about the starting of new ministry.
Yeah.
Tim?
In your packet of paper, there's a guideline for starting a new campus ministry.
So the answer is there is a resource for that. In that packet, guidelines for starting a new campus ministry. All right. Yes?
So it sounds like most of what this is talking about, though, is the campus ministries that are directly established, or the Wesley Foundations coming straight from the annual conference.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I would say the majority of them have a primarily Methodist presence, mm-hmm. but only one of them is a Wesley Foundation, and we've got
right.
about 12 different ones that we're helping to fund and support.
There's
How does this connect with that kind of concern, where they have their own
right.
board of directors, their own policies and procedures?
So you see that one line there at the bottom, working with ecumenical programs, that's my paraphrase of a much longer okay. paragraph. Ecumenical programs, you might be interested in sitting in with Steve Cheney tomorrow. I saw him earlier. Oh, he's over there. He's here. Steve runs a very successful ecumenical program and can give you some clear ideas about that. But what I've told people is that if the annual conference is funding an ecumenical campus ministry, then the annual conference has a responsibility to know about the fiscal matters at that place and have some kind of voice in personnel. That has to be worked out. I mean, it's very careful. In fact, there's a working group called the Ecumenical Campus Ministry Team, ECMT, and we are working to get together sometime around the turn of the year to develop for ecumenical campus ministries a basic policy document about how our different denominations will interact with each other in these ecumenical programs. Well, one of the reasons we're doing that is the question that you ask. Also, because campus ministers will say, well, the Methodists want to evaluate me, the Lutherans want to evaluate me, the Presbyterians want to evaluate me, and so on and so forth. And so they could be saddled with evaluations and assessments, which does not allow them necessarily to do ministry with students. So we want to develop a clear protocol for all the denominations who are involved typically in these ecumenical programs, so we're not burdening unnecessarily campus ministers in those settings, and also giving clear guidance to denominations about what should be expected in an ecumenical partnership. Does that make sense? It's forthcoming. Okay. Let me finish up so you all can go check in and have a little bit of a break. The fifth area of general responsibility is addressing public policy related to higher education. The Conference Board of Higher Education and Campus Ministry is entrusted to do this, to provide counsel, guidance, and assistance to programs in their relationship with the state. So it might be advisable as you're working to build your board to perhaps find some dedicated United Methodist who might have some state interest, either as an elected representative or a staff person or something like that, to help interpret what campus ministry might look like on state university campuses. To interact with public higher education as it reflects on the wholeness of persons and the meaning of life. I put that in quotes because I thought it was interesting. What is going on now is called the unbundling of higher education, where the reason you go get a degree is so you can get a job. The institution of our public higher education colleges and universities were not originally intended so you could go get a job, but so that you could reflect on the wholeness of life, the wholeness of being a person, and the meaning of life, and that this is a public good. So this is a recognition of the original way of thinking about these public institutions was that they created a public good that was a service to the common good. So here's an opportunity for you to go out and seek ways to interject the language of the common good into this process of the ways higher education is transitioning right now. And the third area where I think is quite powerful is working on issues bearing on access, equity, academic freedom, peace, and justice. How can the annual conferences encourage the schools in their area to provide academic access, to provide equality in enrollment, to encourage the safety and care of students? For instance, I could see an annual conference in a state that has open carry on campus laws. I could see an annual conference Beckham creating a policy statement about that, interested in the care and wholeness and well-being of students. This is something I think an annual conference board could do. All right, we are right at 3 o'clock, or actually 3:05. I did grow up not intending to be a preacher, but I guess I turned into a long-winded one. So just a quick question, and then, yeah.
Were there any major changes in this section of the book?
Zero. There were zero changes in this at General Conference. That is I meant to say that. There were some proposed language changes that didn't even get taken up in committee because there were so many other things to take up. All right. Any other questions on paragraph 634? If you have something that you just want to sit down at dinner with me and talk about paragraph 634, I want to do that with you. But I also want to move on really quickly. There are some new resolutions. You should have the new resolution supporting collegiate ministry in your packet. Collegiate ministry is a priority of the church. This is a change in the book of resolutions. The resolutions that you see in the 2012 version, I believe all of those related to campus ministry have expired or will expire at the end of this year, and they're replaced with this one, as well as NARCI. The other one on campus ministry as a valid appointment Is that a resolution or is that added language to the discipline?
That was a resolution, but it left out
four
of the paragraphs.
Oh, it did. Do you want to come up real quickly and speak to these two? So Narcy Jeter is one of the co-chairs of the United Methodist Campus Ministers Association.
Edward
over there. And the coordinating committee of the UMCMA created these resolutions. So if you'd like to speak to those for a little
I'll
bit.
I'll read you the entire thing we submitted.
Is this the valid appointment one?
Yes, this is the valid appointment one. Whereas ministries that provide opportunities for the regular proclamation of the word, the administration of the sacraments, and the ordering of the life of the community for service and mission and ministry should be fully considered as a valid appointment for provisional deacons and elders. Whereas the discipline requires each campus ministry to establish a local church board of directors, including a staff parish committee, providing sufficient supervision for provisional members. Whereas the same ministries are supervised by an annual conference board of higher education and campus ministry or equivalent structure, and whereas the nature of collegiate ministry provides for all of these opportunities and experiences, let it be resolved, they included the let it be resolved, that bishops and district superintendents give full consideration and recognition of collegiate ministry settings and service as valid appointments for provisional members. Let it be further resolved that boards of ordained ministry give full consideration and recognition of collegiate ministry appointments counting towards full connection and ordination as deacon or elder. Because we heard about so many problems with that, we decided to make this resolution. And Michael McCord and Edward McCutcheon helped create this. And other one, do you want me to read?
Oh, they have that one.
Okay.
Yeah, they have the text of the priority of the church.
So, yes.
Yeah. I'm in Georgia, and in North Georgia Conference, we had trouble getting provisional members appointed, or even elders appointed to church ministry for a variety of reasons. But we found the provisional status, it was particularly that they didn't understand that we had structures of supervision built in those foundations. So the purpose of this non-binding resolution was to clarify the structure that's in place, and that the life of an elder and the practice of an elder is included in the work of the collegiate ministry so that it would fulfill that experience as a provisional member. So it's really just a way of clearly stating this is the purpose and practice of giving ministry.
Further validating the language of bishops and district superintendents.
When you have that trouble getting that appointment in place.
And so this was just our way of not changing the discipline, but giving you a resource to fight with. I should have said fight.
We'll say advocate for. But you know, sometimes a little fight's okay. Yes. Well, if you could send me the full text of that, because it's interesting that I can't pull it up on the petition. It's not in the ADCA. It's got that truncated.
I found it randomly. The only two paragraphs in the ADCA are those two. And I submitted
the whole thing. Okay. This kind of gives me, after General Conference, all the approved legislation gets thrown into a stew pot called the red line text, right? And people read through that thing. I'm going to go back and make sure that the full text of this is in the resolution red line. This morning. Okay, please send that to me, because I looked high and low for it, and I just couldn't find it. So I'll double check that in the Book of Resolutions text. All right. Again, this is another opportunity if you want to read through that resolution, have further conversation with Narcy or Edward or Michael. All three of them were involved in the construction of these resolutions. Okay, I am done. Yay! And the good news about this is you really don't have to listen to me anymore, because other people are taking over with the other sessions. I'm happy to have conversation with you about any particular questions that you have, but we worked hard to bring in a number of different voices to give you a broad spectrum of information so that when you leave here, you feel like you've had an opportunity to have the questions and interests that you have addressed. So if you feel like we're not approaching something that you need addressed, please let us know. Tim Moore, right here, is our Director of Collegiate Ministry Training and Resources, and Sheila Bates, right there, is the Director of Student Leadership and Faith Development. And then you can ask the three of us any of these kinds of questions if you feel like we're missing something that you want to hear about. If you have other needs related to housing or meals, please see Steffi back there. You see her, she's in the back, and she will help you get squared away on those kinds of questions.